I'm Max. I'm an Apache Flink committer and also working at Data Artisans. Yesterday, we gave a little bit of an introduction into the system overview of Flink. And because we don't have as much time for the data set training, we decided to skip that and jump right into the dataset API. So if you have any questions concerning how Flink works or how this is executed, you may also ask now during the talk. Be free to ask. So yesterday we covered the data stream API in the afternoon. And today is going to be about the data set API, which is the API you use to write additional batch programs. It is available in three types of languages, in Java, Scala, and Python. Because most people probably are familiar more with Java than with Scala, we will do all the examples in Java here. And you will see that if you've attended the sessions yesterday, that the dataset API is quite similar to the data stream API in many regards. And if you want to look at the documentation, it's available online. But I think now you won't need that. So to give you an idea how the dataset API looks, let's first look at an example. And of course, what could be a better example than the word count? This is a full word count in the dataset API. So it starts with the main method, of course. And then the first thing you do when you write the program is you create an execution environment, which holds the context of your execution. And it's a kind of starting point for every program you write using Flink. So you have the execution environment in this end variable, and then for the word count we want to read from a text file, so we do that using a read text file command on the execution environment, and we pass it simply the first argument of the program as a path to the file or directory where to read the data from, and yes, and then you see that you result actually with a data set of type string. So all the data you process with Flink is typed, so Flink knows how to handle the data and also ensures that you actually perform type compatible transformations when you write your program. So here we have first the string data set, and later we have a data set of tuple 2, where you have both a string and integer as a record. And once you've read your input from the text file, you can transform it using Flink transformations. For instance, here we are using a flat map first on the text data, and then we're grouping by the first field of the record, which is the string field, which is in our case the words we have read, and then we do a reduce group operation. So what are we doing here? Basically, we read the text, and then we use the flat map operation to tokenize the text. That means that we take the whole blob text and split it into words. And then we group by identical words and sum up all the words that are the same. And finally, we write the result as a CSV file. And to run all that, you have to actually call execute on the execution environment. Otherwise, Flink doesn't do anything, because it's all the transformations are lazy by default. So what does actually happen inside, because we created these transformations, flat map and reduced group, and we specified the functions that actually do the work. So we still have to see what does the tokenizer, what does the sum words. So the tokenizer is actually implements the flat map function. So it's just a class. It implements this interface flat map function. We have a flat map function has an input which is string, and in this case, and a tuple 2 of string integers output. So here we receive the text, the input text, and we want to emit later on a tuple which has just the word and the occurrence of the word. So in this flat map function, which we then implement, we have the input string, and we have some collector which we use to output the result. So what we do is we take the entire text we get as input from the file, and we convert it to lowercase, and then split by non-word characters. So it basically means that you will split the text into individual words, and then for all the words you get, you actually emit a tuple with the word and a one. So it's a kind of trick to later be able to sum up the occurrences. So right now we just know a word occurs once, but there might be duplicate words. So we output that, and then we move on to the reducer. So we in the main code we said that then group by the word and then reduce this, and then we specify the sum words class, which implements the group reduce function. And this time we receive as input, we can use this as input, the word and the occurrence, and we actually want to now like reduce the data set such that we really sum up all the word occurrences that have the same word. So we receive here the input, and then we go over the input, and because we grouped by before, we actually receive in this function per call only the words which are the same. So we just have to get the word once, and then increase every time we see the word again, we have to increase the counter and then emit the result. The word and the number of occurrences. Right. Does that make sense to you, or do you have any questions? Yes? The input value is it's the string we read from the file. So if you go back to the program here, we read this text file. So actually the entire text is in this data set, but of course it's not, I mean, data set is just an abstract concept. It's distributed among the workers that execute the word count. If it's a massive text file, it doesn't matter actually, because it will be split into many different parts, and all the machines that execute the word count will receive a portion of the text file. Yeah, and Hadoop splits are a bit different, I think. But Flink is able to partition the file into many more different parts. It just makes sure that it is all the parts are received by some worker. Okay, so now that we took a look at the example, we might want to look at some further concepts a bit more systematically. So we mentioned data types. We can use all the data types which are included in Java, like string, long, integer, boolean, and also arrays if you want. But you can also compose these basic types into composite types, which means that you have a kind of nesting, like in tuples you have multiple of these types in a tuple. And you can also create arbitrary Java objects, but it's not covered here for simplicity. So what is a tuple? Tuple is kind of the standard data type if you work with, if you transform data using the dataset API. It is, it can store one up to 25 values in a record. So it's very simple. Like if you want to have tuple two, like you say tuple two, and you specify the type of each element in the tuple. And if you want to get data out of the tuple, then you select like the first field or second field, and you have to remember that it starts actually with zero and not with one. That might be a bit tricky in the beginning. Yes? Yeah, if you want to have tuple 26, then you'd have to create your own POJO object, which is not a big deal. You can basically just pass your own tuple type, then which, yeah. Yeah, I mean, if you use 25, then I think your program is already a bit hard to read, so you might think of other ways to organize your data. Yeah, why not, if you want. Which would certainly be possible, yeah. There would be some way. Okay. So we saw in the word count that we have the map operation, and there are actually two types of map transformation you can use. You can either use the map function or the flat map function. The only difference is that map function takes an input and produces an output, and exactly one output. So you return just, for example, in this case, you get an integer and you output an integer and multiply by two in the function, and that's your output, exactly one output and one input. So here you multiply by two, 1, 2, 3, 4, and you get 2, 4, 6, 8 as expected. And you can do the same thing with the flat map function, but you use this collector, which lets you output 0, 1, or multiple elements. So this is the same, but it's a bit more powerful because you can you may also output here, for example, the value twice if you want. It's different. I mean, this is like the traditional map, which is also, I think, how it is in Hadoop, and this is a bit more advanced. So then there's a common transformation you might use is the filter function. The filter function, it takes an input, and it signals Flink whether to use this input, further use this input in the data set, to consider it or not. So here, for example, we consider all the values that go in which are not equal to 3. So if we have the input 1, 2, 3, 4, then it's going to output false if 3 goes in here, and it's going to be excluded from the data set. Then also in the word count we saw you can group by, and that means effectively that you split your data set in groups like we did for in the word count, where we grouped all the words which had the same which were actually the same word. So just to show you a quick example, like you might have a data set where you have name and age of people, and your employee data set, and you might want to find out which age group in your company is the largest one, or just get an overview how old people are. So you can actually group by the age here in this case, which is the first field of the tuple, and then apply a reduce function to count the people which are at the same in the same age group. So you have to implement the reduce function. So you would get in all the people which are in the same age group, and then increase the count for every age group, and then output the age group and the number of people who are in the group. So, whoops. So here is the result. So you would see, as expected, the output. Then there's a join operator, which lets you obviously join two data sets. What does that mean? That it means that, for example, if you have a typical kind of web application data where you have an authors table and a post table, and you connect these tools, for example, in a database, you would connect these tools by assigning an ID to an author, and then also for every post that is published on your blog, also assign the author ID, so you know which post is by which author. You can see here that, Fabian has a post, Romy has two posts, and Max actually doesn't have a post. And so you read these two tables in the data set, authors and posts, and then you you actually join these two data sets by doing like authors join posts. And when you join two data sets, you have to specify the fields in the data sets where the join should be where the data should be joined. So in this case, it's ID of author, and here in the posts also author ID. So we say I'm joined with posts where 0, so the first field in authors, is equal to the third field of the post, so the author ID. Well, when you execute this program, then you get actually a combination a joint data set, which we call archive here. So you have basically the two data sets, and you have, you see here that the author IDs match, and so you have all the posts with the author names. So you can see here that, for example, Max is not in the list here because there was no matching post, so he was not included in the join. You may also use a join function. So here we got as a result the whole combination or the whole data of both data sets if the join predicates matched. But you may also only want like the name and the title of the blog post. So you basically do the same as before. You say like join posts, and then you say where the first is the equals the third field, and you, but you additionally you can specify a function here with new posts by user, which is a join function, which lets you determine what data you want to include into the join. So you would receive the posts and the authors and the posts here in your join function, and then you could create a new tuple 2 as an output, which just contains the author name and the title of the blog post. Sorry? Yeah, it's a join function, yeah. It implements the join function interface, yeah. So, yeah. To read the... Yes? The standard join in Flink is an equi join, which would be like a left inner join, I think, in SQL. But there's just you can implement all kinds of joins using a more generic transformation called cogroup. You can read it up in documentation. But yeah, Flink's join is always like this left inner join. And but there's also now some support merged in latest next release. There will be also an outer join, in standard outer join, so you don't have to implement it yourself. You can do that actually. Yeah, you can. I think you can specify multiple fields when you. When you join here, I think you can specify multiple fields here. Yes. So when you, we saw that you can read data into Flink using, for example, read text file. And there are also other ways to do it, like read from a CSV file, or also very. Useful are these collection sources, which collection means like Java collections. So if you have an array list, for example, you can just load it into Flink. Let's see some examples. So using the from elements method, you can just load up some sample data into your Flink program to try out your Flink program, or you can also just pass a collection like an array list here. Then, of course, you can read from a file, text file, CSV file. For the CSV file, you can specify, or you have to specify the, of course, the data type of your fields, because it's just text file, and Flink doesn't know how to convert these text into data types. And you can, of course, also read from HDFS, or it doesn't have to be a local file system. And yeah, you may also ignore fields using this bit mask here when you read data. Yes? Where? Yes. If they are all integers, then you just you would just have this like just integer class. If it depends on how many columns you have, because these are like the columns of your file, of your CSV file. Yeah, if they're all the same, then integer. Yeah. If they're 25, yes, then 25 times like this, yeah. I mean, you can also, of course, always read the file and then transform it later. This is just a way to get like a type data set into Flink instead of just a string, you know, because, yeah. 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 Okay. As far as I know, that's not supported. So you want to basically read a POTRO directly. So you want to say like types POTRO class, for example. That's as far as I know, not supported by Flink. But that doesn't mean you cannot do it. I mean, you just have to read the file text file and then create a map function which takes your input data and emits your type. So that's the kind of way around. Yeah. We just support like primitive types, Java types here in this read CSV method. Yeah, I mean, here you can just use primitive types, but basically you would first read your text file and then create a mapper which creates a data set of type POTRO from your text input. That's not a problem, but of course you can do that, but maybe, yeah. Yeah. It's totally. No, but you're right. It's a feature we could add to the method. It's yeah. Okay. So similar to the data sources, there are the data sinks, which lets you output your data. So you have the write as text, which is the opposite of read text file, and you can also use write as formatted text to apply some custom output for your text. And similar, you can write back to a CSV file. And there are these special kind of methods which you can use to actually materialize and return the data set to your client, which executes the program. So usually Flink, we see what it means. So usually Flink abstracts using this data set concept, but you can actually turn the data set into data and print it or actually get the data set to the client. So if you would normally write a sync here, for example, as text or CSV or format especially, that would be performed distributed on the workers, on the task managers. But when you use these eagerly executed syncs, then the job is executed and the results are transferred back to you and printed, or you can get the number of elements or the actual data set. You see here it's really a list of tuple 2 and not a data set anymore. Can be handy sometimes, but you have to be careful, because if you are dealing with large data, then it might be not very efficient to transfer all the data to you, back to you. So to wrap this up, I wanted to give you some best practices. So we saw that you can use the from collection or from elements method to quickly get a data set, so you don't have to worry about setting up HDFS or creating a file, just load some data. Then you can use print, of course, to print a data set to see what's going on, what you did to the data set, what transformations you performed. And yeah, you can use collect to retrieve a data set, and also very handy is to use a name operation, which gives the operator a name. So if something crashes or you don't understand what's going on in the logs, then you can give it a name to quickly find it. Okay, that's it. Do you have any questions? So, you don't have any questions anymore, then I would advise you to go on the on the web page, which contains the exercises we have for the batch API. So the website, is it in this slide here? Okay, so the website's not here. I will show you the website. So if you go to dataartisans.github.io/flink-training, can you read that address? Then you find this training website, which contains actually lots of exercises. But yeah, we don't have so much time today, so I would advise you to take a look at the exercises, and then just start with the first exercise, which is called mail count, where you get some data from a mailing list archive and then compute some statistics on it. So you can go here, click on it, and it will tell you what you have to do, and also if you need help with setting up, it has some instructions here in the overview. And if you have any questions anytime, just ask the other Flink committers, which are here, mainly in this corner. just raise your hand, and then we will help you out. All right. Thank you.